You're gonna leave here without them? And run off on some wild goose chase halfway across the galaxy just because you found a discrepancy in a hydrogen cloud?
Doctor, I'm chasing the captain, Lieutenant Uhura, and Ensign Chekov, not some wild aquatic fowl. This is the only lead we've had.
That must be 24 light years away.
11.630.
Are you suggesting that they could have transported over a distance of... You're out of your Vulcan mind, Spock.
I'm suggesting nothing, Doctor. I'm merely pursuing the only logical course available to us.
We've lost Jim and the others back on Gamma 2. Now you've dragged us out here 12 light years on some wild hunch that...
Doctor, I do not respond to hunches. No transporter malfunction was responsible for the disappearance. They were not within the Gamma system. A focused beam of extremely high intensity light was directed into the Gamma system from the trinary system we are now approaching. No known natural phenomena could have caused that beam. Does that clarify the situation?
No, it doesn't, Mr. Spock. It's still a fancy way of saying that you're playing a hunch. Well, my hunch is that they're back on Gamma 2, dead or alive, and I still want another search.
Dr. McCoy speaks for me too, sir.
See. Gentlemen, I am in command of this vessel, and we shall continue on our present course. Unless it is your intention to declare a mutiny.
Mr. Spock.
Who said anything about a mutiny, you stubborn, pointed-eared? All right. If we don't find them here, we still have another search on Gamma 2.
Agreed. Interesting. No power source. It may be shielded.
And it may be just a wild goose chase like we've been telling you.
I shall beam down, Doctor. If I'm unable to communicate, a landing party may be necessary.
Well, Mr. Spock, if you're going into the lion's den, you'll need a medical officer.
Daniel, as I recall, had only his faith. But I welcome your company, Doctor.
Now, how are you with primitive radio equipment?
Very simple. Amplitude modulation transmission. Simply adjust the frequency, throw this switch, and the Enterprise should answer.
That was the Jailbreakers with their latest recording. On Request Time, brought to you by Bang Bang, the makers of the sweetest little automatic in the world.
Fascinating.
And very simple.
You'll need readings on 3 light wavelengths from the enzyme recorder.
I am familiar with the equipment, Doctor. We're wasting time. The shuttlecraft is ready.
You're determined not to let me share in this, aren't you?
This is not a competition, Doctor. Whether you understand it or not, grant me my own kind of dignity.
Vulcan dignity? How can I grant you what I don't understand?
Then employ one of your own superstitions. Wish me luck.
Is it me, Jim? Am I so sentimental that I just have to keep believing that he's still alive out there in that mass of protoplasm?
I recommend you abandon the attempt.
Do not risk the ship further on my behalf.
Shut up, Spock. We're rescuing you.
Why, thank you, Captain McCoy.
Shuttlecraft to Enterprise. Request permission to come aboard.
Spock, you're alive.
Obviously, Captain. And I have some fascinating data on the organism.
Don't be so smart, Spock. You botched the acetylcholine test.
Letters. Bring the shuttlecraft aboard, Mr. Scott.
Aye, sir.
Dr. Mabinga interned in a Vulcan ward. He couldn't be in better hands.
Then you and I are transporting down ones.
I can't leave Spock at this time.
You just indicated you could. There are Klingons here. If their mission is a legitimate research interest in the planet's organic potential, then you're the one man who can tell me.
And if that's not it?
Then I need help. Advice I can trust as much as Spock's.
I appreciate the compliment, Jim, but...
Bones, I'm as worried about Spock as you are. Kirk here.
Spock, Captain. I trust all has gone well.
Spock, are you alive?
An illogical question, Doctor, since obviously you are hearing my voice.
Well, I don't know why I was worried. You can't kill a computer. What he's saying, Spock, is that a man holds that much power, even with the best intentions, just can't resist the urge to play God.
Thank you, Doctor. I was able to gather the meaning.
It also proves another Earth saying. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. Darn clever, these Earthmen, wouldn't you say?
Yes. Earthmen like Ramses, Alexander, Caesar, Napoleon, Hitler, Lee Kuan. Your whole Earth history is made up of men seeking absolute power.
Now, Spock, you obviously don't...
Obviously, Doctor, you failed to accept...
Gentlemen, we've just been through one civil war. Let's not start another.
I don't like it, Jim. A vessel this size cannot be run by one computer.
We are attempting to prove that it can run this ship more efficiently than man.
Maybe you're trying to prove that, Spock, but don't count me in on it.
The most unfortunate lack in current computer programming is that there is nothing available to immediately replace the starship surgeon. Most illogical. Of all people, he should have known how the computer would perform. Of course, the M5 itself has not behaved logically.
Please, Spock, do me a favor and don't say it's fascinating.
No, but it is interesting.
Compassion, that's the one thing no machine ever had. Maybe it's the one thing that keeps men ahead of them. Care to debate that, Spock?
No, Doctor. I simply maintain that computers are more efficient than human beings, not better.
But tell me, which do you prefer to have around?
I presume your question is meant to offer me a choice between machines and human beings, and I believe I have already answered that question.
I was just trying to make conversation, Spock.
It would be most interesting to impress your memory engrams on a computer, Doctor. The resulting torrential flood of illogic would be most entertaining.
Fascinating. This atmosphere is remarkably similar to your 20th century. Moderately industrialized pollution, containing substantial amounts of carbon monoxide, and partially consumed hydrocarbons.
The word was smog.
Yes, I believe that was the term. I had no idea you were that much of a historian, Doctor.
I am not, Mr. Spock. I was simply trying to stop you from giving us a whole lecture on the subject. Once, just once, I'd like to be able to land someplace and say, behold, I am the Archangel Gabriel.
I fail to see the humor in that situation, Doctor.
Naturally. You could hardly claim to be an angel with those pointed ears, Mr. Spock. But say you landed someplace with a pitchfork.
Odd that these people should worship the sun.
Why, Doctor?
Because, my dear Mr. Spock, it is illogical. Rome had no sun worshippers. Why should they parallel Rome in every way except one?
Even more fascinating. Slavery evolving into an institution with guaranteed medical payments, old age pensions.
Quite logical, I'd say, Mr. Spock. Just as it's logical that 20th century Rome would use television to show its gladiator contest. Or name a new car, the Jupiter 8.
Doctor, if I were able to show emotion, your new infatuation with that term would begin to annoy me.
What term?
Logic.
Medical men are trained in logic, Mr. Spock.
Really, Doctor? I had no idea they were trained. Watching you, I assumed it was trial and error.
Are they enemies, Captain?
I'm not sure they're sure.
Interesting. And given a conservative empire, quite understandable.
Are you out of your head?
I said I understood it, Doctor. I find the checks and balances of this civilization quite illuminating.
Next, he'll be telling us he prefers it over Earth history.
They do seem to have escaped the carnage of your first three world wars, Doctor.
They have slavery, gladiatorial games, despotism.
Situations quite familiar to the 6 million who died in your first world war, the 11 million who died in your second, the 37 million who died in your third. Shall I go on?
And violate your oath regarding non-interference with other societies. I believe you all swear you'd die before you'd violate that directive. Am I right?
Quite correct.
Must you always be so blasted honest?